Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasambuddhassa. Buddhang dhammang sanghang namassami. So last night we had the novice ordination for what's his name? Chandasilo. One of the when Ajahn Chah died, Lumpa Mahabua came to Wat Bapong to support the community of disciples of Ajahn Chah, and he was giving a talk, and he gave a talk, and he talked for a while, and then he went on a bit of a tangent, and talked, and then about after a while, then he sort of burst out laughing. He said, "You know, there," he said, "you people are really fortunate. Now that I'm getting old, I forget what I'm talking about, and so I have to start again." And he says, "So actually, you know, in the old days, I just started talk about one thing, and now you're getting 2, 3, 4 talks in one, you know, because I keep forgetting and start over again. So you're really fortunate." So that memory is impermanent, sanya anicca. Yeah. That reality of change. But anyway, last night we had the novice ordination. Tomorrow will be the bhikkhu ordination for Samaner Jitapalo. And these ordinations are really helpful reminders of the possibility of relinquishment of living the life of a religious seeker, and whether one is taking on the robes oneself, or one has been ordained for a long time, or whether one is a lay person living in the world, still having that ideal and that possibility of a holy life is really important. And the last night, when Samaner Chandasilo making his aspiration for taking on the novice training, and there's a couple of lines of the, you know, sabba dukkha nisarana nibbana sacci karanataya, and to cross over all dukkha for the realization of Nibbana. And that's not a foolish aspiration or a deluded hope. That is a very real possibility that we should all be considering as within this human existence and this opportunity that we have of having come into contact with the Buddhist teachings, with this Dhamma, this truth that he pointed to. To cross over all dukkha, to realize Nibbana, to realize the relinquishing to abide in what is truly peaceful. And to remind ourselves that is the goal. And of course, when, say, as a religious seeker, again, whether one is a monastic or a lay person, that sense of being a religious seeker is really important to remind ourselves of that possibility. And reflecting on, like, one of the word that sabba dukkha nisarana, so nisarana is to cross over or to move away from or to escape, and that's it comes up in a teaching that the Buddha gives in many places, where, and even he actually defines his awakening. It wasn't until gratification or the pleasurable experience of something, it's called asada. It wasn't until I saw that fully and completely. It wasn't until I saw the adinawa, the danger or the drawback of different things, and until I saw the escape or the possibility of crossing over of moving past, moving through, freeing oneself from, it wasn't until he saw that within himself that he could declare that he was fully awakened. So that sense of just being, these are themes for reflection. What is the pleasant sensation? What is the pleasant taste of an experience? What's the drawback? What's the danger in it? And what's the escape? What's the way? 'Cause it isn't through annihilation or trying to prop up something that is, because that's where the Buddha says, there are these in his first discourse, the idea of, like, the escape is not in, say, like, bhava tanha, vibhava tanha, of trying to get something to desiring of trying to hold on to something or trying to get rid of something. Those are not a balanced middle way of realization. It's always through relinquishment and non-attachment that the Buddha points to the escape, to that ability to cross over all dukkha. And so that sense of getting the flavor of that, and particularly the flavor of what's the flavor of, say, of nisarna, of that crossing over, that escape from that which is binding, holding, containing us in a way that is conducive to dukkha, to discontent, to dis-ease. And there's a very beautiful sutta where the Buddha speaks of the escape, and he speaks of it in terms of the escape from sensual desire, sensual pleasures, ill will, harming, which are the thoughts. And when the Buddha get like the in the Eightfold Path, when the Buddhist makes a right view, then right intention, right thought formation, and say what is wrong thought formation, wrong intention, is those intentions toward sensuality, toward ill will, to thoughts of harming. But the opposite is true. What is it that is right intention, right volition, right sort of right thought formation? And of course, thoughts of renunciation, thoughts of loving kindness, thoughts of compassion. But then the Buddha also there's also escape from, say, from form, and then the escape and in terms of the formless, because we tend to seek our security in that which is formed in some way, something that's defined, something that we think we can find security in. And then the last thing that the Buddha points to as that binds us, holds us, and we can escape from is identity, the whole sense of sakkaya, that sense of creating an identity around this body, this mind. And in that sutta, the Buddha points, of course, there's the repetitive language, and where the Buddha is saying, well, there's the case where a mendicant has eager, kind of confident, settled, decided upon sensual pleasure, but doesn't find, the mind can't quite, not really that settled on it, not really that decided on it, sort of like, is this right? But then the mind becomes eager, confident, settled, decided on, say, renunciation, relinquishing. The mind sees that as something that is more promising, more conducive to well-being. And this is in the, Buddha, or that person is then, that mind is in a good state. It's well developed. It's well well risen. Well, you know, well settled in that. And because of that, then it doesn't experience the kind of the distress and fever of sensual pleasure, of that's or that gravitating and seeking out that gratification through the senses. And so in that way there is an escape from that sensual pleasure, that sensual gratification. And then doesn't the Buddha goes through the same with the so like with ill will. When the mendicant is not eager, not confident, not settled, not decided on ill will. I mean, there's the tendency or there's the habit that's there, but then, there's this, and I think we all feel that, where that ill will, aversion, irritation, it's like a well-worn track in the mind, or it's something that the mind has goes toward because it's not getting what it wants or it's not getting what it likes. But then, it isn't that, it's seeing more clearly and it's not eager, it's not confident. But it's when the mind can lift up and has developed, is confident in goodwill, in loving kindness, in that formulations, volitions, thought formations of loving kindness, of goodwill, of well wishing. And so, yes, that's, the mind can be eager in that, can be confident, can be settled upon, it can be decided, clear, okay, yeah, I can give myself to this. That is something worthy of giving oneself to. And develop, and, the mind can become, well developed and well well trained in that, and having seen that clearly, and then because of that, then one does not experience the distress and agitation of ill will, because it's by its very nature. It's always going to be painful in some way. It's always going to be unsatisfying. There's that tendency to negativity doesn't give the results, or it gives results but not satisfying ones. And then of course the same with thoughts of harming. It's overcome through the mind seeing clearly that there's a sense of non-harming, of compassion, is the way that the mind crosses over, has its escape from those thoughts of harming, of where there's a the wishing of harm, and whether it's whether it's something minor or whether it's a major black sort of state, invest in, or just that. But it's that recognition, that as human beings, we all, as sentient beings, not just as human beings, as sentient beings, we all suffer, or we all experience these limitations, and there's that compassion and wish to alleviate suffering, and be a force for that settling of dukkha. And so that motivation and those thoughts of compassion that's the escape from dukkha. This is crossing over dukkha, realizing peace within this present moment. The sense of form, where. And it isn't just sort of physical form. I mean, that's what our normal assumption would be, and the normal translation of the word. It's rupa. But there's all the other different ways that we create form and structure and solidify our experience, or the world around us, or the assumptions that we have about the world, or our need to have that kind of form and structure, and having everything spelled out clearly, having it all set in stone, and then I can be happy. That's just not the way the world works. And so the ability to be comfortable with the formless, to be not be intimidated by the formless, and formless can isn't just some void, but to being comfortable with spaciousness, to be comfortable with silence, to be comfortable with stillness, where the mind takes delight in that, or is at least not shaken when there isn't something tangible for the mind to hook onto and say, yes, This is the way it is. This is the way it's going to be. This is how it always was, and now the world is all right. But that ability to let the mind see the it's like within whatever form there is, there's always the formless surrounding it, a part of it, integral to it. Whatever kind of form there is the space around it. There's whatever thing that we can conceive of. Yeah, space and the formless is much, much more predominant. When we think of, what is, say, the meditation hall at Abhayagiri? You think, well, it's that building with the walls and whatnot. And yeah, I mean, the walls take up some space, but what's much more functional and much more predominant, what makes it so pleasant, is the space. But we don't usually pay much attention to it. Our attention gets drawn to things and thingness, so that sense of the mind being eager, confident, settled, decided upon the formless, and so that one is comfortable with that sense of formlessness of space, which doesn't mean one sits around and meditates and gets spaced out and is isn't able to deal with form, isn't able to deal with detail. It's like, I remember, just think of my own experience with, say, Ajahn Chah or other exceptional teachers. They're people who pay attention to the details, but they're comfortable with things falling apart. And they're comfortable with things being very open and unsure. And it's, of course, that's how Ajahn Chah translated or expressed another aspect of impermanence is also, anicca is also, the uncertain, the unsure. And so there's that formless is creeping into it. And I've seen different teachers, and they're like that, whether that sense of, they pay attention to the details, but if it all falls apart, they're completely comfortable and happy. They like things structured and done well, but when they're not going to completely lose it if something doesn't hit that standard. So that's it's just not creating dukkha, that crossing over of dukkha, having an escape. So it's when that mind is in a good state. It's well developed. It's well trained. Well settled. And it doesn't engage itself in the distress and the agitation of form and the attachment to the form. And of course, exactly the same with identity. We invest in the sense of identity, of who I am, who I should be, what my body should be, what my mind should be. If I were a good meditator, how peaceful my mind would be, how wise I would be. These are identities. That we pick up, and we create a sense by investing in that identification with body, with mental states, with moods, with feelings, with conceivings of what should and what shouldn't be, how the world should and shouldn't be. These are all investments that leave the heart agitated and distressed. So that being able to be that, having that sense of an eager, confident, settled, decided upon, the relinquishing of identification, and finding that's where our peace is, that's where our freedom is. And it's not spacing out into being a nothing, a being a nobody. That's another identification. I'm a nobody. And it's just creating another identity that we are trying to fit into something that we make solid. So this sense, there can never be anything that is actually worthy of creating an identity around. I mean, even taking the identity, I'm a Dhamma practitioner who sees the Dhamma. that'll collapse pretty quickly if you hang on to it. So it's but it's just this ease with, oh yeah, it's just what it is. And of course that's the fundamental insight that the Buddha points to of like in his first discourse of Anya Kundanya, his first insight into Dhamma, into the truth of the nature of things, and that say, yeah, whatever is of the nature to arise, that is of the nature to cease. And that's an insight that's not beyond the capability of any of us. But it's learning how to internalize it to realize it or to make it real within our experience, not to skip over it or not to kind of brush it aside, or you know all the different ways that we actually kind of try to protect ourselves from realizing truth, or that we shut ourselves off from the experience of truth. So it's that we're, you know, what we're not trying to get rid of anything. It's like the truth of Dhamma is being displayed all the time. It's just being able to see it, experience it, be ready for it, and you know we experience the world around us. We experience the different aspects of the world, whether they're pleasant or unpleasant, and don't have to close ourselves off from anything. It's sort of like that. It's like in the commentarial literature, there's a beautiful story where the Buddha on the eve or the, you know, before his awakening, before his sitting under the Bodhi tree and realizing enlightenment, he receives these eight handfuls of grass that he uses as his meditation seat on the night of his awakening. So it's like the what is that point here? And Ajahn Chah, remember him saying, yeah, this is a pointing to what did the Buddha sit on? Did he sit on, you know, eight handfuls of grass and help his butt not get too sore? Or did he sit on the eight worldly dhammas? That was what he was sitting on. That's what he was, you know, on top of. That was the basis of his, this praise and blame, this whatever the world revolves around, he was sitting on top of it. Praise and blame, gain and loss, fame and disrepute, happiness and suffering. This, the world is constantly revolving around that. The Buddha sat on top of that, and that was his, that was the basis for his awakening. It wasn't that he didn't have to get rid of all that, and then he could finally realize awakening. He was above that. It was the basis of his reflection, investigation, understanding. So that kind of that language that the Buddha uses in his that discourse on escape, and he said that eager, confident, settled, decided upon. Yeah, these thoughts on renunciation, on loving kindness, on compassion, on the formless, on the relinquishing of identity, identification. And those are to reflect, this is the way we can cross over all dukkha to realize nibbana. To offer that for reflection this evening.